Hello, I'm Paul. I'm from Nutrient Nirvana. And today I'm joined by Nigel Howitt, aka Lawful Rebel. I came across Nigel's channel fairly recently, and I was genuinely floored by the variety of subjects that he's able to speak on and his ability to articulate them so well. So please check out his channel, Lawful Rebel, on YouTube and other platforms like BitChute and Odyssey. And his excellent website, lawfulrebel.com. All this will be linked underneath the video. So, hello, Nigel. How are you doing?
I'm very good. Thanks very much, Paul. And thank you for that kind welcome. Appreciate that.
It's a pleasure, mate. It's a pleasure. So, I was recently going through your website and I came across a mission statement, which I found really interesting. And if it's okay with you, I'd like to read it out to the viewers.
Yeah.
So Nigel's or the Lawful Rebel's mission statement is as follows. As I rebel against ignorance, I stand for wanting to know. As I rebel against chronic disease, I stand for optimal health. As I rebel against evasion and willful blindness, I stand for becoming more conscious. As I rebel against the parasite class who seek the unearned, I stand for production and independence. As I rebel against coercion, I stand for reasoned persuasion and demonstrating what I know to be right. As I rebel against tyranny, I stand for freedom. As I rebel against altruism, I stand for rational self-interest. As I rebel against collectivism, I stand for individualism. As I rebel against mysticism, I stand for reason. And as I rebel against falsehood, I stand for truth. So that's fantastic. And as I read through that the first time, I found myself nodding my head, you know, to every single statement there, bar one. Okay, so there's one thing in there, and I paused on this and I reflected, and I'm not sure I understand completely where you're coming from. So, and that was, I rebel against altruism. I stand for rational self-interest. So as I understand it, altruism, I've actually got it up here. So altruism is like a selfless act. It's like putting yourself before somebody else, or putting somebody else's interest before yours, I should say.
Yeah.
So on the surface, that sounds like a really good thing. So when you came out with that particular statement, where exactly were you coming from? Can you elaborate on that, please?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it does sort of great, and it points to one of the great myths in what I call the matrix, the mainstream culture. And it is counterintuitive, and I'm not remotely surprised that you would pick me up on that. Altruism is an ethical idea. It's a morality, and it's a code of self-sacrifice, and it's often confused with kindness, consideration for others, helping, and all these other marvelous things that you and I all do. You know, we do these things, but altruism, the idea, is much deeper than that. It's a morality around self-sacrifice, and it has an implication of moral duty. So if you are morally obliged to help your neighbor, if we think about it for a moment, if it's a duty, if it's an obligation, if you must, well, then you've just destroyed the whole concept of kindness. The idea of helping is something that you choose to do, and that's what makes it so beautiful. The idea that it should be compulsory just, you know, takes away, you know, human volition, and it actually destroys consideration, kindness, generosity. But it's more than that. Altruism is poorly understood, and as I said, it's generally associated with being kind, and I've got nothing against being kind. I'm right up for being kind. But altruism, this code of self-sacrifice, it's all about putting other above self. And if we think about that rationally for a moment, that's anti-life, because every meal that you eat you could give to someone else who's hungrier somewhere else on the planet. But you need to eat. You need to breathe. Breathing and eating are the most selfish things you can do, because we have to rationally maintain our own lives. You know, health is something we have to sustain our own lives with our own choices. Life's given to us, its sustenance is not. So it's entirely rational to be self-centered, you know, this idea of meanness and evil. But to be self-centered, to be rationally self-interested, is fundamental to your survival. And the thing, the component that perhaps escapes people is that it's in my rational interest and yours and everybody's to get on well with people. Mm. It's not in my rational interest to barge into queues and to grab the best of things. Mm. And to, you know, that would be irrational behavior. That would be counterproductive to my own self-interests. Mm. So, maybe I've said enough there to give you a broader.
I do get where you're coming from now, totally. When I read that and I sort of reflected on it, it kind of reminded me of when many, many years ago, I used to work in the healthcare profession. And some of the best nurses that I worked with, they were, you know, they would literally sweat blood on a shift trying to do their very best to help the people they were looking after. And I often found that these people suffered with depression in their lives and stuff. And so I guess, is that kind of where we're coming from with?
Well, I think so, because the idea of altruism and self-sacrifice are absolutely mainstream driven into us. Okay, we're all born, we're born in this cultural climate where self-sacrifice is bigged up. So of course everybody wants to virtue signal.
Yeah.
And many people who have little self-esteem for any other reasons will always grasp at that straw of, well, at least I can help other people. So there's a always a predisposition amongst people to, if you can't think of anything else, just self-sacrifice, just do stuff for others. And this is a sort of a reach for automatic response that's generally probably not considered. And I'm sure most people are coming from a good place because, you know, as I mentioned previously, you and I were all interested in being kind and helping people. I mean, you know, it would be almost inhuman not to. Mm-hmm. But this doesn't mean that you should actually put the requirements of other people above your own, because that would be silly. You know, if you're absolutely dog tired and you haven't eaten, you really need to sort yourself out. It would be stupid to go out and spend the night helping people when you really need a good meal for yourself, have a bath and, you know, tuck yourself up early. Mm. So, you know, it stems from the fact that altruism is absolutely fundamental to the mainstream culture. But more than that, you see, Paul, it's altruism is incompatible with freedom. And where we're at the moment, everyone will be aware that freedom is really in a critical state. We're losing our freedoms hand over fist. Mm. Most people don't appreciate that altruism is actually incompatible with freedom. Altruism is a moral code for slaves, basically. If you think about it, if you have a moral duty to sacrifice to other, and that other is either your neighbor or it's the king, the pharaoh, the you know, it's God or it's society, it's always something else other than you.
Mm.
And this is essentially programming people towards giving up. And if you imagine a parasite class of people who might want to control humanity and gather all the resources for themselves and have a free ride, this would be a really perfect sort of morality to try to instill. And bingo, that's what we've got. And it was the work of Ayn Rand that helped me shatter that myth. If anybody's interested in pursuing it, she wrote a great book called The Virtue of Selfishness, which utterly smashes the myth. And the beauty of it is that it's completely rational. And to the extent that we can just look sensibly at the issue and zoom out, see the big picture, I think most people ultimately get that we've all been programmed with something that's really well worth questioning.
Mm. Yeah, I completely agree. I totally see where you're coming from now. Talking of Ayn Rand, she's somebody that I haven't got round yet to reading, which is something I really need to do because her name crops up all the time in these circles. But I did once see her on the Phil Donahue show. It's a clip on YouTube, and it's really interesting. I highly encourage people to go and watch it. And I'm pretty sure she said that tax was a bad idea. It's really counterproductive to society. She said that the what should take its place basically is philanthropy. So I guess really once you get to a certain level of how much money you've earned, you kind of donate the rest of the money to replace that tax system. Is that not a form of altruism?
I don't think so, because it's voluntary. If we pause for a moment on an average, don't quote me on the statistics, but if we just have a quick smattering look at the tax burden, it's been said that the average person in the UK works between 8 and 9 months a year to pay tax. And you need to think about this for a while. You need to think about all the cumulative tax of every product made, every part transported, every worker, all of the tax costs, and it all adds up and up and up. You know, not to mention income tax and sales tax, you know, at both ends as well. So if you imagine for a moment that you were not taxed at all, can you imagine how much more money you'd have? Mm-hmm. Can you imagine how much money we would have to help each other? We would be extremely wealthy. And you know, it's a whole other conversation about how, you know, the progressive income tax is designed to sort of keep the wealthy class that are there already wealthy, mm-hmm. and stop anyone else like you and me from climbing up the wealth ladder. Because, you know, anyhow, that's another conversation. Mm-hmm. But the point being that I don't think it is altruistic, because it's voluntary to help people. It should always be voluntary to help people. And that's where the joy of it comes in. You know, we all know that if somebody just ordered you to go round to that old lady's house and sweep up, and you had to do it because the local Communist Party said that was your job, where would the joy be in that? Mm. But if you know of a friend or somebody in need, and you think, do you know what, I've got some spare resources, I'll go and spend the evening helping them, or you know, I'll do something to help, and that's where the good feeling comes from. It's because we choose it. Mm. So yeah, that's my take on why that wouldn't be altruistic.
No, that makes perfect sense. So something that we share a lot of commonality with is on the subject of health, because as I understand it, you eat the ancestral diet. And am I right in saying that?
I suppose broadly speaking. I mean, we can modify that as we go, but yeah.
Yeah. So it's something I've been doing as well. And I've recently spoken to Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride, Clive DeCarle. These people are also on board with this way of thinking. So why did you choose this way of eating? And is this the way everyone should be eating, do you think?
Well, I would, I'm happy to talk about how I eat and the reasons why I do what I do. I would always hesitate to be prescriptive, because we're all different. We are all different. And I think discovering how to sustain one's life is a personal journey that everyone should rightly undertake. And in that process, you know, we discover things. I mean, some of us have various allergies to casein proteins in dairy products, for example. So we have to be careful with prescriptions. But broadly speaking, I suppose if I, you know, to the extent that my diet is ancestral, it's avoiding processed foods and, you know, the modern seed oils, the modern predisposition to gorge on sugar, and these sorts of components. I'm not actually against dairy. I think some of the diehard sort of, ancestral diets, you know, the what's the name for it? I forget now.
Primal paleo, or
paleo. It's the paleo, isn't it? That's the word I'm looking for. I think some of the hardcore paleo dietitians steer away from dairy, but I don't do that. I think that the challenge around food is that there are, of all the different kinds of food, whether it's meat or vegetables or whatever, there's healthy meats and there's unhealthy meats. Mm. There's healthy vegetables and there's unhealthy vegetables. There are healthy fats and there are unhealthy fats. Mm-hmm. So it is really, really very difficult for people to work out. Not impossible, but it does take a personal journey.
Well, I think if people take the approach, you know, if you kind of imagine the world without supermarkets, or, you know, just how people used to eat 100 years ago or so, they were probably far healthier collectively than we are today. That's how it would seem to me anyway. There seems to be a lot of chronic disease, autoimmune disorders around. And from what I understand, this all stems from gut health. And the worst foods, as far as the gut is concerned, would seem to be like processed foods, fast foods, sugar, and all these foods that are relatively modern. So I guess, you know, the ancestral diet, from my point of view, from the way I see things anyway, that would seem to be a lot more beneficial to people than, you know, going to Tesco's or whatever and buying stuff from there.
Absolutely, and I'd throw bread into that, and that's another sort of controversial one. I don't think bread is at all helpful in our diet. And when we talk about ancestral and paleo, wheat is essentially a grass, and it's great for grazing animals, but it only started to be consumed by humans about roughly 10,000 years ago. And interestingly, that is coincident with something of a decline in human health. But the interesting thing about bread these days is that it's produced with copious amounts of glyphosate. Mm. And glyphosate being this sort of ubiquitous antibiotic, it's an antibiotic, it's a desiccant, it does many things, but it's used in weed killers and things, and it's widely sprayed on almost all our crops. Mm-hmm. To such an extent that, in fact, that it's almost ubiquitous in our environment, which is tragic.
Yeah. It's even sprayed in kids' playgrounds and places like that, isn't it? It's unbelievable. Yeah.
It's shocking. And one of the disastrous consequences of glyphosate in the diet and copiously in bread, because it's sprayed on wheat as a desiccant to dry it out, usually before it's harvested, probably less so on organic bread. But the bad thing about wheat products and bread particularly, and glyphosate in general, is that it causes leaky gut. It plays havoc with your gut's ability to maintain all the tight junction links between all the cells throughout your epithelial layer of the gut. And as a result, your body effectively doesn't know where the outside world starts and ends. And things that shouldn't get into your blood system, into your immune system, do get in, and obviously things can leak out, and you know, you've got havoc as a result of glyphosate.
And there's this common misconception out there that red meat, or meat in general, is much harder for us to digest than the say plants or fruits or whatever, but in actual fact the opposite is true, at least by, you know, from what I've researched and what I've found out so far. So when you say this to people, they're amazed. They're actually, no, you know, you get the funny look and the rest of it. But that would seem to be the truth. And I mean, I've been eating this way now for probably around 10 years. And fats don't make you fat, for example. You know, I eat quite a high fat diet. I eat a lot of meat, fish, eggs, butter, all these great foods. And I don't put on any weight at all. So there is so much there's so much misconception out there when it comes to diet and foods at the moment. And I've also noticed that because I regularly research health, I found that if I go onto Google and ask a very straightforward question like, is meat bad for you? The answers they're putting out there now are very different to what they were doing like 6 months ago. There seems to be a real kind of push towards veganism or vegetarianism, and as you said yourself, you know, one size doesn't fit everyone. So for us all to be moving towards this plant-based diet, it would seem to be absolute madness for many reasons.
Yes, I mean, this is another area where I challenge the matrix view, the mainstream cultural thrust is towards vegetarianism. You know, meat is bad. And it's tied in with climate change. I haven't found any evidence to back that up at all. In fact, on the contrary, I think you can get away with eating no plants, no carbohydrates, because your body has no actual requirement for carbohydrates as a macronutrient. You can get away with just eating animal products, as indeed many of our ancestors have, various groups around the world, from the Maasai to the Inuit, you know, the Eskimos. So many cultures have survived purely and simply on animal fat. Yeah. And animal products, I should say. So it's a myth. This is rammed down our throats with increasing intensity, as you point out, and it's just not true. Yeah. I mean, you say you spoke to Natasha Campbell McBride recently, and I love her take on plant foods versus animal foods, and she considers the animal foods as providing the building blocks for our body, you know, and everyone's familiar with the idea that we rebuild our body probably roughly every 7 years or whatever it is. It doesn't really matter what the time frame is, but we're always rebuilding our body. We have to keep replacing dead and dying cells. So the actual sort of building blocks, if you like, the Lego pieces that we need to construct a new body with, come from the animal products, Natasha Campbell McBride was saying. And this isn't to say that plants aren't good for us, because she was saying the many medicinal properties that various plants have. And I think this is fantastic. And of course, plants taste nice. Vegetables are great. I like loads of vegetables. Mm. I don't think they're a necessary thing to exclusively eat. Dr. Campbell McBride goes on to say that some people are often do very well when they turn vegetarian or even vegan for a while, because of the course that they're sort of, they're on
going, yeah. Yeah, yeah. They're basically cleansing their system, aren't they? Yeah. I think she describes plants as basically like cleansers, but they don't provide us with the building materials, as you say, to rebuild our bodies. So, yeah, totally. It also makes me a little bit resentful towards my parents for forcing me to eat vegetables when I was a kid, because I didn't need to. I went through all that agony. So, yeah, crazy world. Anyway, So what do you think about supplementation? Do you supplement a lot with different things? Where are you with that at the moment?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I do supplement. I mean, one other caveat I just wanted to add to my diet is it's largely ketogenic. It's largely a high-fat diet, as you've said. Very carefully chosen fats, animal fats, healthy fats. I eat a lot of raw butter and things like that, and beef tallow, some coconut oil and stuff like that. But so cyclical ketosis, I'm careful to keep the high carbs, the processed sugars and crisps and pizzas and all that sort of stuff well out. But yes, the issue of nutrition, the issue of nutritional supplementation is quite an important one. And I do personally supplement with just one or two choice things. I think if you eat a lot of high nutrient foods, I'm particularly fond of organ meats from grass-fed organic animals. Again, it's really important to source meat and meat or any particular product you go for. It's really important with particularly animal products to go for grass-fed and organic. If you eat a lot of things like liver and other organ meats, you get a huge number of nutrients that will be absent in from your diet if you don't.
Yeah.
But there are things such as ubiquinol or CoQ10, as some people might know it. I supplement with that because as you get older, the body, I think above the age of about 30, decreases in its ability to produce this enzyme, coenzyme Q10, or its reduced form ubiquinol, which is actually just a little bit more bioavailable to the body. So that's why I take that one. So that's an example of one thing that I supplement with. I also supplement with magnesium because, almost everybody is deficient in magnesium.
Yes.
I also supplement in vitamin D3 and vitamin K2 as a combined supplement.
Yeah.
So there are a couple of things that I think are useful to add to our diets. And maybe to the extent that we choose our diets really carefully make a conscious effort to nourish ourselves, it becomes less important. But there's definitely gaps there, even to the well-intentioned shopper going out and buying things, because you know, food production methods have exhausted soils and, you know, minerals are deplete.
So I think it is good. Getting back to magnesium, I think it's I think it was Clive de Cole that said that we burn magnesium when we're stressed, and particularly over the last 18 months, the vast majority of people are probably suffering with unnatural levels of stress. So it's probably 95% of people in the West are magnesium deficient, and it is such an important nutrient, isn't it? It does so many roles in the body. So
absolutely. And interesting you mentioned that, so involved with stress, because there's been a lot of stress recently with the alleged pandemic. But magnesium is depleted in most soils. It's absolutely essential in the body. You can't really, it's difficult to measure as well. I think some people, when they try sort of measuring it in the blood, it doesn't actually sort of linger in the blood much. It needs to be in your cells. So one interesting thing to note, if any listeners out there experience any cramps at all, you know, I think they call it Charlie horse in the States, but basically leg cramps. You know that, you know, at night sometimes when you stretch your legs.
I used to get that, yeah.
Yeah, that can be a signal magnesium deficiency if anybody gets that. So it's I think that's top of the list of nutritional supplements.
Yeah, I think we're definitely on the same page there. I mean, at the moment, I personally don't believe in taking loads of pills, you know, loads of different nutrients. You need to try and get as much as you can from your diet.
Yeah.
But I do take magnesium every day. I do take vitamin D3, K2 throughout the winter. We're both in England. I take every now and again, I take iodine. I think this is really good for clarity of thought. It just cleans you out. That's a good thing to do. And I do every now and again top up with vitamin C, ascorbic acid. So pure vitamin C, I do that quite a lot. And that's a good thing for people to have in their medicine cupboard. If you ever feel like you're coming down with a cold, you can do what Linus Pauling suggested, the Nobel Prize winning scientist. You take a teaspoon of vitamin C in a drink. As soon as you feel like you're coming down with something, you repeat that every hour. And probably within 3 or 4 hours, you'll find that the cold or whatever it is has completely disappeared. So that's a great thing to do as well. So yeah, so we're definitely on the same page with all that. Is there anything else you kind of advocate health-wise? Anything else like I don't know? What do you think about exercise? Do you do earthing, sun gazing, anything like that at all?
I do a lot of these things. You know, health is a consequence of all our lifestyle choices. Health's an achievement; it's a result. It isn't really a natural birthright. You know, that some people might like to think. Yes, our bodies all want to be healthy, and as long as we behave in the correct way, you know, i.e. eat, exercise, etc., in a way that our bodies require, then of course the outcome, the result, the achievement of health is what happens. And I think there are a lot of other components. Earthing, you touched on there, is a useful component. Getting proper night's sleep is absolutely essential. I do exercise. I think, you know, I mean, I'm in my 50s, and I think it becomes essential to do some strength training and things. So I'm a big fan of this KAATSU blood flow restriction training. Actually, it's something I'm just looking into at the moment, just starting off with. But I think exercise is a really important component. But I think also an underappreciated component of health, and sort of conversely of ill health, is EMF exposure. And this is really worth looking into, the work of Dr. Martin Paul and many others who have written on the subject. It's important to grasp that these days we are drowning in a sea of electromagnetic fields and electromagnetic radiation of various frequencies that is billions of times stronger than anything that our ancestors would have been exposed to. I'm not only saying be cautious, I'm saying that there is science out there that shows that accelerated aging and cellular free radicals, free there are there's a couple of different oxidative components, which are the names escapes me at the moment, but the consequences of exposure to EMFs of various kinds cause damage to your mitochondria and within the cell with reactive oxygen species. That's what I was going to say, reactive oxygen species and indeed reactive nitrogen species that are, you know, I won't elaborate too much just to confuse people, but this is all it's all discoverable with something called voltage gated calcium channels, which are forced to open through EMF exposure. And it causes all sorts of damage within the cell. And the problem you see, Paul, is it doesn't happen overnight. You know, you don't sort of switch on your phone and have a few long conversations over a weekend and then you fall ill on Tuesday morning. It doesn't work that way. These things, you know, like all chronic diseases, we develop them over years, over decades.
It's accumulative, isn't it?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So that's the main component. I would advocate caution with EMFs. You know, don't have Wi-Fi in your home, have everything wired. You get faster speeds, you get better security, and you get better health. So it's kind of a no-brainer. But caution with mobile phone use and the whole shooting match really with EMFs. That's one of my pet hobbies, I suppose you could say, in terms of exploring a not particularly well looked into component of good health.
Yeah, that's great advice. So final thing on the subject of health, this is something that's been puzzling me for a while now. So why are so many lovely people out there seemingly completely apathetic when it comes to their own health? So, you know, when I'm going through people I know, family members, friends, whatever, and I try to wake them up or wise them up to this sort of information, and they've often got, you know, considerable health issues of their own. They're going through things. There's just this wall there. There's just, not with everyone, but with a lot of people, they just cannot see that this information is the real thing. It's going to help them, you know, that they can overcome their issues naturally. Why are most people apathetic to this sort of information, do you think?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it really is a mystery because, you know, taking care of or learning how to sustain your own life is really, you know, the basic idea, the basic principle of any kind of personal development. It really, you know, before we start worrying about a load of psychological stuff and personal development and get into spiritual ideas and stuff, really we need to learn how to look after ourselves from a health perspective, because you know, the heart attacks and dementia and strokes are all totally preventable, and it does seem utterly baffling that so many people are completely uninspired to safeguard their own well-being into that long-term thing, that long-term future. And I think that sort of gives us a bit of a clue to it. I think it's a failure of thinking. I think it's a failure of long-term thinking. It's a failure of thinking in principles. It's also perhaps a little bit of an evasion. It takes effort, doesn't it? It takes effort to subordinate taste to health. And this is an interesting one because, you know, women might say of men, you know, in terms of sexual promiscuity, if I could use a slightly risque analogy here, you know, if we were all to just follow our desire for sensations and act accordingly, you know, with promiscuous partners and so forth, we would rightly say that that's not the way to go. That's not the way to do it. And yet people behave in exactly the same way with regards to satisfying the sensation pleasures of their taste buds. And they will sacrifice any sort of long-term considerations of health or well-being or anything, you know, for the gratification of a pizza or a donut or an ice cream or you know, actually ice cream, you know, you can get healthy ice cream, don't get me wrong, but there's an inability, I think, in most people to realize that in the sense of our values, your life and its furtherance and its sustenance should be a greater value than the short-term taste sensation of you know, your favorite poison.
Yeah.
And they also, I think, don't appreciate, maybe in when you and I are trying to enthuse these people, then maybe they don't get that there's a whole, you know, there's a whole host of fantastic flavors out there to be discovered in terms of other foods. And as we shift our diet towards one that supports our life rather than undermines it, there's still amazing tastes to be discovered. So maybe there's that component too.
Yeah, quite possibly. You're quite right. I mean, speaking for myself, I woke up or wised up around 15 years ago. And this was one of the subjects that initially woke me up, I suppose, really. I remember listening to Dr. Joel Wallach. I don't know if you've come across his name before.
His name rings a bell.
Yeah, quite a famous American doctor. And he did a very famous lecture called Dead Doctors Don't Lie. And which was great title. And basically he was listing all these various illnesses and diseases and saying these are all nutrient deficiencies. So if you get more of this specific nutrient, you can overcome these problems. And I remember thinking this was wonderful information, but I was also quite angry to find out that it was basically this simple and we'd all been lied to for so long. So, I mean, it's very frustrating. I get very frustrated talking to some people and they just cannot comprehend what you're saying to them, that it's just that simple. It's a simple thing.
It is a real challenge. I mean, here's another component to answer that question as well. I think most people will think, well, how do you be healthy? Go and see the doctor. You know, he's the one that's qualified. He's done the course. And of course, you know, you and I, and probably your listeners as well, and most of mine will already appreciate that your doctor doesn't get any nutritional education. He's basically there just matching symptoms with, symptoms and illnesses and drugs. He prescribes drugs, you know, he prescribes antibiotics. He doesn't address root causes. So the main thing about our doctors these days is that they don't know how to be healthy. And I know that might upset some people, there's a good deal of evidence that backs that up. And people still out there in the matrix and the mainstream culture, in that mainstream narrative, of course, your doctor is still king. You know, he's the one to go to, actually probably more when you're sick rather than to know how to be healthy. But there is an implicit, assumption in there that he knows how to be healthy too. And because your doctor doesn't talk about grounding or ketogenic diets or the importance of sleep, the importance of pure water, you know, he doesn't talk about any of the fundamentals, gut health. I mean, how many doctors appreciate that gut health is really the foundation of your bodily health? It's really important.
All disease begins in the gut.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's another reason, I think. Yeah. But I mean, Paul, I've been trying to get my wife as enthusiastic about health as I am, because I quite selfishly want her to live a long time with me. I want to live a long time. And even I'm a great believer that you can't sort of tell people what to do. You can only try and inspire them. You can only try and demonstrate something that works, perhaps works better than what they're doing. But so far I still haven't managed that one.
I guess we're all different. I'm in the same boat as you, really, when it comes to that. You know, my wife is. I mean, she does supplement with one or two things, and generally speaking, as time's gone on, we're both moving in that direction, but we're not exactly on the same level, I guess. But you know, I guess everyone's different, and they'll get there in their own time. And as you say, you can plant these seeds and see what happens.
Definitely. Absolutely. Keep sowing seeds as well. That's what I do. I mean, I don't want to denigrate my wife too much. I mean, she's great.
Me. I'll be in trouble.
She's probably not that bad in relation to what some other women could do. But I do try to persuade her, I do try and illustrate that there are things that it's really, really sensible to get interested in, you know, to really hold as a value, say that is really important to me. And it comes down to that long-term thinking that, you know, every time you put something in your mouth, you've got to be thinking what's going to happen 30 years ahead. You know, that most people just don't do that. It's all about immediate gratification.
Yeah. And plus really, I suppose you know, a lot of what we've talked about so far with regards to glyphosate and spraying of crops and things like artificial sweeteners placed in virtually every kid's cordial drink and things like that, you know, a lot of this has been done deliberately. And it initially made me angry. When I woke up, my first kind of response to all of this was anger. I went out and I did it all wrong. I was angry and I sort of, you know, shouted at people that I loved and said, look, this is happening. Rah, 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 rah. And that's not always the best way to go about things. But, you know, initially I was coming from a place of anger with all this information. It really angered me that, you know, that they're trying to keep everyone down to a certain level with their health so they can function, they can go to work, they can perform a job, and that's pretty much it. They're not going to thrive or flourish at all with a supermarket diet. And that should make people angry.
It should do. And I think the key there is that a sick population is a controllable population. And, you know, for any listeners that are already on the same page with the idea that we're controlled, it's not a conspiracy theory. It's widely published, the agenda for global globalization, global governance. For control, for even population reduction. But when people are sick, they are stressed, they're in need, they're not able to reach out, and you're certainly not growing, you're not challenging, you're not moving forward, you're not really sort of thinking and developing and, as you say, thriving. You can't do that when you're sick. Yeah. You're pushed back into that sort of self-defense mode, and you're very, very easily controllable. And of course, there's the fear component, you know, which tends to shut down the frontal cortex as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, people should get angry that a lot of it is deliberate. The agenda away from meat, the idea that EMFs are harmless. Mm. You know, there's a lot of disinformation out there. I mean, and we should rail against that by going on a personal crusade to find out how to be healthy. And the other thing to remember when trying to be healthy is that, you know, hesitate to ask your doctor. I think doctors are great for diagnoses, by the way. That is the one thing I would always go to the doctor for. Get a diagnosis and then say, cheers, mate.
Yeah, thanks, yeah, I'm off, yeah.
But the other thing is that we can't, it's too dangerous to sort of look around at our culture, see what our friends and neighbors and family are doing and do the same to be healthy. Unless you do know someone who is exceptionally old and healthy and, you know, and obviously doing something right, then obviously chat to them. But generally speaking, the idea of following the herd in this context that we're in today is another very dangerous strategy. I'm sure you know, and probably your listeners do too, that it's a personal journey where you have to be prepared to go against the grain. You have to be prepared to step outside of what everyone else thinks, what everyone just knows. And well, is that really true? And actually be evidence led. It's a question of always trying to look for that rational argument that persuades you, for example, that, you know, ketosis might be a great thing to do to lower blood sugar and perhaps treat or prevent diabetes, for example. You know, when we look at the facts that support these things, and when we learn to predispose our investigation towards uncovering the rational argument, that's what you need. What we don't need is assertions. You don't need, oh, you should do this, you should do that, I'm a firm believer in this, we should, you know, all this sort of stuff is, you know, just amounts to hot air, really.
Yeah, people need to question more, don't they? That's the big thing at the moment. You know, I think that's why we find ourselves in the situation we're in at the moment, is because not enough people question authority or what they're being told, particularly when it comes to science and nutrition and health and things like this. So, yeah, I mean, hopefully it will turn around eventually. We'll have to see, but we can only do what we're doing, and hope that more people receive this information and sort of entertain the idea of thinking for themselves.
Yeah, I agree, Paul. I think that, you know, it will turn around, but the old phrase, how much suffering do you need, springs to mind, because unfortunately the vast majority of human beings seem to consider suffering as their number one teacher. and they tend not to affect any change until it hurts so much doing what they're still doing. And again, this is where the long-term thinking comes in, and you know, preemptively planning an outcome, looking to the long-term future. I think things will change. I mean, I'm not that optimistic that things will change anytime soon, if I'm honest, because all the signs are that, you know, people are quite happy sort of plodding along as they are. You know, there'll always be individuals, I think, coming to that insight like you and I have done, where you think, gosh, you know, there's a whole fantastic voyage of discovery here that is so rewarding. It's so exciting. It makes you feel so good to know how to look after your body. When you can really say to yourself, God, you know, I know how to be healthy. And that's a huge self-esteem boost, which is very, very enjoyable. And I suppose people do have problems overcoming smoking and drinking and even food addictions. Addictions are a challenge, but you know, if we take things one step at a time, it's all achievable.
So that kind of leads on to one of your other statements on your mission statement, which is, as I rebel against tyranny, I stand for freedom. So I think most people would agree that tyranny is a bad idea. It's a bad thing, like war, famine, toxicity, and all the other things we've discussed today. And yet these dreadful things are omnipresent in the world at the moment, aren't they? They're everywhere you look. So, you know, this is a question for you, Nigel. Why is that, and what can we do about it individually and collectively? I know it's a big question, but...
Yeah, that is a big question. So what can we do about this tyranny that's coming individually and collectively? It's difficult to advocate collective action. I mean, first and foremost, it has to become from the individual. And I think the seed of it all is the birth or rebirth of the individual into, my goodness, I need to start thinking. I need to start learning how to take care of myself. I need to know more. I want to know. I want to challenge what I'm being told and find out what's true. Because a lot of people these days will know that the mainstream narrative fails to make sense on so many levels. There are so many contradictions within a narrative that's full of lies, and there will always be contradictions within where there's falsehood. That there's necessarily going to be contradictions, and it's important, I think, for people to remember that, in terms of, you know, a fundamental thinking principle for rational thought, is that contradictions don't exist in reality. You know, you can't be hot and cold at the same time. You can't be here and in another town at the same time. So when we see a contradiction in the narrative or in explanations, in counter explanations that contradict each other, we know that at least one of them must be wrong. And these days, in a narrative that is all around, you know, this idea, this sort of medical cartel controlling us through ill health, whether it be through an alleged pandemic or just through all the chronic diseases that people develop over decades, we must realize that I've just lost my thread. That's annoying. I'll pick it up in a second. That's right. In terms of contradictions, we must realize when we look into the narrative and we see all of these things that don't make sense. The contradictory rules, you know, how come, you know, the time constraints and this and that, and the, you know, the quarantining this long and that long, and you can find so many contradictions within all of the rules. And I think if people bear in mind that means that there's some falseness there somewhere, there's ultimately a lie going on, and if that stimulates them to ask questions, as you said earlier, people need to question more. They need to question and sort of develop a degree of confidence in their own ability to find truth, because the truth is discernible. And, you know, as you look for that rational argument, we can determine what's true and what isn't. Yeah. It's a big call, and I think a lot of people are challenged by breaking away from what the mainstream culture says. You know, if the mainstream culture says vegetarianism is a good idea, or that, you know, there's a climate emergency and that carbon dioxide is the enemy, if that is said by enough people, the vast majority of individuals will be deeply challenged to go against that or to dare question it. Well, how can little old me go against everyone else? But, you know, we live in an age, in a post-truth era, and there's a considerable falsehood in the mainstream narrative. And yeah, so how can we, just bring it back to your question, what can we do individually and collectively against tyranny? We can be thinking individuals, because if we had a population of independent thinking people who valued reason and their own knowledge and self-esteem above just going with the flow, going along with what everyone says, then we wouldn't be in this position. You couldn't have a civilization of rugged individuals controlled in the same way. If we're all go along, happy to do what everybody else says, oh, I'll go along with that, I'm not going to bother looking into that, it's too much effort, that is the road to tyranny. As soon as people don't feel inclined to bother to think and challenge what they're told, that's when tyranny has a free ride.
Yeah, and I think as well, something else is that a lot of people have been induced into a state of fear, haven't they? And obviously, when you're living in fear and you're frightened of something, you're not likely to get to that stage where you can question things and authority and think for yourself.
Yeah,
you're just too scared, and you just end up doing what the monster tells you to do.
Absolutely, that is true. And in some respects, this is in why this dents my optimism for any change too soon, because those who would seek to control us and influence us to act against our own rational self-interest, they've been doing this for years, for decades. And when people just start to question things, you have to realize how late in the day they're coming to the game, if you like. The people on the other side, you know, for scores of years, arguably for hundreds of years, have been laying plans, having meetings, writing up agendas, you know, getting in consultants, working out, you know, psychological profiling and plans and marketing and propaganda. There's been huge resources dedicated to influencing people to act in ways that aren't necessarily in their own rational self-interest. So again, there's a massive need for people to do a lot of catching up. And I think also, Paul, for something of a counterculture, there's a need for us all to come together, all of us thinking people, to somehow network, and, you know, not through Facebook or any of the other social media platforms that are obviously already sort of eavesdropped on, you could say. But there is a need for a counterculture, and that's my one optimism, is that I think a genuine counterculture could be born in the current context.
Definitely. And I mean, I'm actually quite optimistic, because I've, over the last few weeks, I've noticed some people, some friends and a couple of family members who I never thought for one moment would ever question the official narrative on anything whatsoever. They're starting to do it. They're actually starting to do it. I am seeing signs of progress on that front. So I'm quite optimistic. Probably like you, I think we're in for a long journey with all this, but I am optimistic that the outcome is going to be a positive one. I do think that.
Good. Well, I'm all for being buoyed up. And whenever I hear stories of individuals and people, you know, that are starting to question things, I mean, that is very, very encouraging. And bring it on. And I think something that we can all do is to continue to have conversations with people on a personal level. We have to be cautious, because no one likes to be told that they're wrong or being told what to do. If we can phrase our conversations around just throwing out questions, as you mentioned earlier, sowing seeds, that's something that we can all do as well, isn't it?
Definitely, yeah. So one last question for you. I saw one of your videos recently. I think it was called Why Do Some People Never Wake Up? And in that video, you addressed the term waking up, and you said it was not a very useful or very good term to use. Could you explain to my viewers why that is, why you think that way?
Yeah, sure. I think it's a metaphor, of course, for, you know, becoming more conscious, that has some use, but I think it's quite limited, because what's really required is the acquisition of knowledge. To become more aware, we need more conceptual knowledge, in a nutshell. And the idea of waking up is a sort of a dead end. It's a binary state. You're either asleep or you're awake. Once you're awake, you're there, you've achieved it, and there's nowhere to go from being awake. So there are a number of reasons that I go into on that video that really make the metaphor, I actually go as far as to say, an implicit call to inaction, because there's a danger that when people consider that they're awake, that they can sit back on their laurels and sort of watch what happens from the ringside, and the perhaps the motivation to carry on learning, which I think is the root of the solution. People need to acquire knowledge. It's a process of learning. You know, learning doesn't stop when you leave school, and unfortunately that's a sort of an assumption that most people have. Most people don't pursue lifelong learning. So this metaphor of waking up has the danger, I think, of, you know, turning people into sort of being armchair pontificators on what's going on. Obviously, not all people. That's just the danger. That's the limitation of the metaphor. It does serve for some people, and, you know, I hear a lot of people say it still. It does have some value, because, of course, you know, when you think of people being asleep, they're completely unconscious of what's going on. But yeah, I just have that caveat on its use, where I think if we're not careful, it carries an implicit call to inaction.
And there's many people, in fact, the vast majority of people, that work long hours, work 6-7 days a week sometimes. You know, some people now have 2-3 jobs, and they struggle, I suppose, to find or have the mental energy to be able to go on this path when they're working so hard and life is so busy. Does there need to be like a sea change in the way people approach life in general, I suppose, really, you know?
I think there does. I really do think there does. I do think there is an imperative for people to live in a completely different way. Now, I mean, you know, this is a really big idea, but, you know, the idea of living differently, we need a new culture. We need to get rid of that one. We need to bring in a new one. You know, the problems of our current Western culture are so systemic and fundamental that it's difficult to know how to fix it. But you're absolutely right in that most people just don't have the time to spend educating themselves. And really, you know, school has done a bad job for most people. It sort of conditions and indoctrinates and sort of dumbs down, and it leaves the student after 12 years thinking, God, thank God that's over. You know, and you're left with this idea of education that's something you just want to shake off and get away from, which is tragic, because, you know, it should be an ongoing process.
I hope you don't mind me asking this question, but I know you have a family. Are you a homeschooler, or are you wonderful to hear. That's great. So is that a very difficult challenge to do, or?
Yes, it is a challenge. Again, it takes time. You see, there's the challenge that people have, because they're so busy working, and it's completely understandable. If you've got to go out and earn money to pay the rent and to sustain your life on that fundamental level, you clearly can't wise up and gain the knowledge. Then also there's the, in terms of homeschooling, it's a great thing, I think, to liberate children from school, but of course it requires at least one person to be at home to supervise, to be with them. You can't just so there are obvious challenges around that with, you know, two income households and things like that. So there are vast challenges. I mean, the homeschooling thing itself is quite a large topic. We don't do much school at home, as it were. We don't do many formal sit-down lessons. I focus on trying to demonstrate you know, sort of a basic form of sort of functionality, basically basic ability to function as a human being. I know it sounds quite a broad abstraction, but my wife and I encourage our children to do things, to be creative, to make stuff. We don't force them to even learn to read before they're ready to. So we tend to sort of support them, but at the same time, you know, I'm very interested in the world around me. So I tend to sort of throw a lot of that at my kids, or you know, my children tend to hear it in our home environment, shall we say. So that's probably not common to most home scenarios. So that's my way of educating, as opposed to the sitting down at desks, you know, with a whiteboard and sort of going through stuff in a more formal way. There's a whole spectrum of ways that you can approach home education, I think, Paul. But I almost think being out of school is in itself a huge positive already, even before you begin the process of education.
I discovered recently that in Sweden, children don't go to school until they're 7 years old. I'm pretty sure that's right, which I found very interesting, because in this country, we send our kids out to nursery school at three or something like that. And I've always thought that was a bit odd, you know, and I think perhaps they're trying to tear the child away before the age of seven, because the age of seven is quite an important age with children in terms of their mental development. So that also is something I think people should perhaps consider to do, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the Rudolf Steiner schools and others recommend starting at a similar age, and there really isn't any hurry. I mean, the common objection that people that you meet when you suggest that children don't not go to school is that most parents will immediately think, how are your children ever going to learn to socially adapt and make friends, as though they're going to somehow end up being deficient by not being in this artificial environment we call school, with an arbitrary age range of people all their own age, which you never meet in reality. And the truth is that children learn to socialize very, very adequately. I mean, there is no cause for concern whatsoever. You know, I think actually on the contrary, children learn better because they're in a realistic environment of you know, multiple age groups all over the place, friends, relations, aunts, uncles, cousins, neighbors. They're in the real world, and I think in that environment, you know, left to their own devices and perhaps encouraged, that they do fine.
That's a great observation. You got time for one more question?
Yep, absolutely.
So I'd like to ask you, what initially put you on this journey, or how did you wise up or wake up, or however you want to put it? What started you off on all this?
Yeah, that's another good question. I mean, I think 9/11 was a seminal moment for me, where it was a real shake, a real shoulder shake, you know, metaphorically speaking. I suddenly thought, my goodness, there's something big going on here, and I'm not convinced it's what I'm being told. And I've always sort of, I suppose, had a predisposition to question things, you know, even through the 90s. I was raised a Christian, as a Catholic. I never quite bought into the, you know, that sort of religious culture that I was born into. I was always sort of questioning that. But yeah, 9/11 was a quite a big jolt, and sometime after that, I was over in the States, and I was in a bookshop and stumbled across a David Icke book, and I started reading some of his stuff. I don't agree with everything David Icke says. He talks about a lot of things which I'm a very evidence based, very very reason based, reason, evidence, proof, and logic. Not to say that I don't have a mental box marked the unknown. You know, you can't explain everything, and you do have to have a mental file in which you put things that you can't explain at the moment. But he did really sort of get me thinking, and I read a few of his books, and it one thing led to another. So it was. I mean, I'd probably thank David Icke as being the, you know, the author that first really got me into a high gear on that.
I'll always defend David Icke to the death. You know, there are things he talks about that he or anyone else can't really prove at all. You know, he does go out there. But at the same time, you know, if somebody watches his presentations at Brixton Academy or Wembley Arena, he does like 12-hour talks, which is incredible. And I would say, you know, at least 11 and a half hours of that is extremely valid stuff. You know, it's very important information. And he gets it across really, really well. So I'm a big Dave fan, really.
I am too. I mean, I owe a great debt. I think he's done really well at presenting a lot of controversial topics in a really accessible way. He's a likable guy, and I'm a big fan too, so I don't knock him. My only sort of bugbear or problem with a lot of truth seekers, and you know, I may well come under fire from almost everybody here, but it's as soon as people go into mystical realms or entertain things as true for which they have no proof, evidence, and logic, that for me rings an alarm bell. Because for me, Paul, I think, well, what is your standard of truth? And for me, my standard of truth is reality. As soon as one is prepared to believe something or accept it as true without evidence, if there's no accepted evidence, or if it's circumstantial, or if it's pretty loose evidence, you know, if it's hearsay, you know, for example, people talk about past lives, you know, people talk about them, and the only evidence is what people say. This for me isn't enough for me to say, yep, we can assume that that is true. It's still in that box mark, maybe, you know, of course we can't know. But the big thing about being a truth seeker is that we really need to establish what is our standard of truth. At what point do we say we can be certain of this, it's true, and how do we distinguish that from, well, this might be true, but we don't actually know yet, so we're going to have to put that in a separate category. And I think it's really important to do this, because when we look at the existence of certain microbes that are alleged to be causing illnesses at the moment, you know, we have to really, really go to the fundamentals. And to David Icke's credit, he does go right to the fundamentals there when he talks to Andy Kaufman and others. But so many people, you know, they are prepared to believe in things that either there's no evidence for, or in fact there's evidence that contradicts it. So for me it comes down to a question of what's the standard of truth. And I think it's important to have a standard that you can refer to. And if you don't have one you can refer to, well then where are you? How do you know what's true or
not? Well, I suppose some people would say, or I would say, that I've had a subjective experience of the mystical, or whatever you want to call it. So through my own experiences, I strongly believe that there is more to this reality than we see in front of us, much like what David Icke talks about. I've experienced this myself. So I guess, you know, coming at it from a subjective angle, would you agree with that at all?
Well, I've walked on hot coals, for example.
Really?
You know, it's impossible to walk on hot coals. They're 1200 degrees Celsius. They should burn your feet.
Yeah.
Somehow my feet didn't get burned. So I am also on board with the idea of experiences that we can't explain. And clearly, something happened in which my mental state was pumped up by the procedure that I was put through to do this, let's call it a ritual, this activity, this amazing thing. And somehow, I don't know how, I was able to exert control over the outcome of what should have been burnt feet. So I get this thing about there are things that we can't explain, but I'm quite strict on myself in putting that in a box marked unknown. And what I don't do personally is leap to conclusions, if you like. There are lots of things I don't know, but I'm very cautious, shall we say, not to leap to conclusions.
Skepticism can be a very healthy thing, can't it? Definitely. I totally agree with you. Well, thanks very much, Nigel, for coming on. I've really enjoyed that. I was really excited about today and speaking to you after discovering your channel and your website, and it's been even better than I thought it would be. So hopefully maybe one day we can do this again. There's probably another 10,000 questions I can ask you about various subjects. So, and anyone who's watching or listening to this, please check Nigel's website out, lawfulrebel.com. Please check out his YouTube channel, because there are an awful lot of videos on there on a variety of subjects. And as I say, mate, I really admire the way you articulate your thoughts. You come across really well and you're very thought-provoking. So thank you very much for coming on, and I hope to see you soon.
Thank you so much, Paul. I really appreciate that, mate. And likewise, I've really enjoyed the conversation. Questions are fantastic, and I love questions. And, you know, you fielded some great questions, and you know, it's wonderful to be in conversation. So thank you for inviting me on. It's a great pleasure.
Cheers, Nigel. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, mate.
Yeah.